Okay, well, welcome everybody to tonight's Hoffinger lecture. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Mike Seidman, who is the Carmack Waterhouse Professor of Constitutional Law at Georgetown. After graduating from Harvard Law School, Professor Seidman began his law career as a law clerk to Skelly Wright on the D.C. Circuit and then clerked for Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall. He was then a staff attorney with the D.C. Public Defender Service until he joined the Georgetown Law Faculty in 1976. And since that time, he has been a tremendously successful and creative legal scholar in the fields of constitutional and criminal law, writing predominantly from the perspective of critical legal studies. And he's the co-author of a fantastic constitutional law casebook that almost makes me wish that I taught constitutional law. And just to give you a sense of his stature, he was elected to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences last year as a testament to a broad body of work. And I tried to figure out how I could possibly distill that for you without taking up all of his airtime, and that's pretty much impossible. So I'm just going to leave out most of the constitutional law and tell you that it's amazingly interesting and you should take a look, and focus on criminal law and his criminal law work, which is truly thought-provoking and also a pleasure to read. So I want to just highlight two of the pieces or works to call your attention to that I think give a good indication of the overall body of work. So one is a recent book that he wrote called Silence and Freedom, which is really a fascinating look at the relationship between silence and how it's tied up with notions of freedom in different contexts. So for example, he points out how when people choose to be silent, how that in many ways is a much more meaningful than language, and is an act of defiance in lots of different circumstances that are so interesting to read about. So for example, he talks about when martyrs refuse to renounce their religious views, or when draft resistors refuse to take the military oath during the Vietnam War because of their view that the war was immoral. Those instances of silence really spoke volumes about what it was that they were defiant against. And more recently, he discusses the prohibition on torture and how we could think about prohibiting torture in a sense to recognize the right of an individual to be silent and keep control over the connection between their mind and their body. It is a great book that I highly recommend to you. But the other piece that I highly recommend to you, I think we're going to get a really good preview of tonight, I'm guessing. I'm intuiting it because the title of this one is a recent article in the Ohio State Journal of Criminal Law entitled Hyper-incarceration and Strategies of Disruption, Is There a Way Out?, which is somewhat similar to tonight's talk. And in this piece, which I think we'll hear at least somewhat more about, there's an analogy to the lack of public outcry in the context of the United States mass incarceration to the response to the Holocaust in Nazi-controlled Europe. So that's pretty provocative. I suspect we'll be hearing about that. And so I don't want to highlight more of this piece because I'm anxious to hear all about it, but I did want to highlight a closing observation from that article because I think it'll put us in the mood. So I'm quoting here, "There's no good way to deal with overwhelming evil, but there is surely a way not to deal with it. Willful blindness, craven apologetics, and flaccid acquiescence are not options when millions of our fellow inhabitants are behind bars. Like the people of goodwill trapped in Nazi Europe, we opponents of hyper-incarceration need to confront the truth of our situation and be honest about how bleak the prospects are. But pessimism should not be confused with passivity. Even if our efforts accomplish nothing at all, and whatever form our politics take, we must do what we can to stop the horror. Our personal dignity demands no less." And given the persuasiveness of all the things you have written, I have a feeling by the end of the talk tonight, we'll all be marching out of here like a call to arms, ready to go. And so with that, I am very pleased to have you here at NYU, Professor Mike Seidman. Thank you.
Yike, what am I doing? Not off to a good start here. Rachel, you are so nice. Thank you. It's just a tremendous pleasure and honor to speak here at the Hoffinger Criminal Justice Forum. I have to tell you, the honor comes with a fair amount of terror. I generally try to avoid situations where I'm talking before people who know more about the subject I'm talking about than I do. In this case, I'm afraid my ego got the better of my judgment. I think it's fair to say that there's nowhere else in the country where as many people deeply knowledgeable about criminal justice gather in one room, except to paraphrase the old joke about Thomas Jefferson, when Jim Jacobs dines alone, or maybe when Jim Jacobs dines with Rachel Barkow. In any event, it's a tremendous tribute, I think, to Jim and to Erin Murphy and to Rachel that they've managed to establish and maintain a forum where people of goodwill can talk seriously and intelligently about a vitally important question that rarely gets the kind of serious and intelligent treatment it deserves. So my modest hope for myself tonight is that I don't dishonor the tradition that they've established. As Rachel said, my topic for tonight is the familiar problem of hyper-incarceration. Before this audience, I hardly need to spend a lot of time dwelling on the underlying facts. From 1975 to 2009, the number of people incarcerated in the United States has grown from 380,000 to about 2.25 million, an increase of almost 600%. On a per capita basis, these numbers put us far ahead of any other nation in the world. And for the latter part of this period, most of the increases come about at a time when there's been a declining rate of crime. As astounding as those outcomes are, they understate the impact on the African-American community. Black men are more than six times more likely to be incarcerated than white men. 20% of the black men born between 1965 and 1969 have been imprisoned by the time they reach their early 30s. According to Bruce Western, Meredith Claycamp, and Jake Rosenfeld, 29% of black male high school dropouts under the age of 40 were behind bars on an average day in the year 2000. Now, all of this is old, if nonetheless deeply depressing news. What is new is the beginnings of efforts to change the situation. We can start with the fact that perhaps because of our very high rate of incarceration, although that's certainly disputed, crime rates have declined dramatically. And perhaps in part in consequence of those declines, for the first time in recent memory, state rates of incarceration are beginning to stabilize or decline, although that effect is masked by the continuing increase on the federal level. There were also the beginnings of a political backlash against hyper-incarceration, and all over the country, including here in New York, there are promising experiments with a variety of new approaches to rehabilitation, reconciliation, and alternative sanctions. So all of that is undoubtedly, in some sense, good news. As my wife, who was nice enough to be here tonight, never tires of telling me, though, I get a kind of perverse pleasure out of being able to detect the dark cloud behind every silver lining. I've made a reasonably successful career out of doing that, and I see no reason to stop now. So most of my emphasis tonight will be on detecting, some might say, obsessing about the dark cloud. And my basic thesis is this. It is, in fact, possible that we are on the verge of a secular change in incarceration rates, although it's too soon to tell, and there are good grounds for skepticism on that score. In any event, though, the important point is that there has been no change in the underlying dynamics of race, class, social collapse, and legitimation that produced the hyper-incarceration problem in the first place. So here I want to associate myself with a variety of scholars, such as Loic Wacott, Nicola Lacey, Bernard Harcourt, who have traced mass incarceration to the requirements of social control of an underclass in societies with neoliberal economic systems. Because those dynamics haven't changed, declines in the incarceration rate are bound to be accompanied by, indeed are already being accompanied by, the rise of other mechanisms that serve the same purpose. In some respects, those mechanisms are less brutal and dehumanizing than the ones they replace, but in some respects, they were even more worrisome. Now, in order to make this case, I want to start by talking at some length about what I take to be the underlying problem. It's no secret that a big part of that problem relates to racism and classism. I think, though, that the nature of racism and classism are widely misunderstood. The standard liberal story is that racism is a kind of perceptual mistake captured by the familiar and reassuring refrain that race is only skin deep. On this view, people who are racists act irrationally. They are blinded by race prejudice that causes them to distort reality. Now, I don't want to deny for a minute that this is part of what racism consists of, but a complete description of the problem, it's woefully inadequate. One way to see its inadequacy is by looking at cases where race really does seem to make a difference. People who believe in the standard story are unable to account for those cases. So, for example, and this is hardly a random example, we're faced with the deeply disturbing fact that young black men are responsible for a wildly disproportionate percentage of street crimes, robberies and muggings and so on. So what are we to make of that fact? If one believes in the standard story, there are really only two possible responses. One response is to deny that it is a fact or to willfully ignore it. When liberals do this, they bring discredit on the liberal project because the fact is true and cannot be ignored if we want to think seriously about crime and the incarceration problem. The other response is to recede from the claim that it is wrong to engage in racial profiling. When liberals do this, they cease to be liberals. Yet, that conclusion seems to follow naturally from the premise, because racism is equated with irrationality, because that's just what racism is, it follows that it's not racist to act on rationally defensible generalizations. The way to avoid that problem, I think, is by recognizing that racism is not, or at least is not just, irrationality, individual prejudice, and an individual moral failing. Racism is not an individual perceptual mistake, but a system of subjugation that is self-perpetuating and gains its power from the fact that it creates the circumstances that makes it seem sensible. To understand how it works, it's useful to tell the parable of the white waiter and the black customer. Imagine that one day the black customer sits down to be served. Perhaps the white waiter is prejudiced against African Americans, or perhaps he's had a bad night's sleep or had a fight with his partner. It hardly matters. For whatever reason, he's surly and provides bad service. Understandably, the black customer leaves no tip. On day two, when the black customer comes to be served, the white waiter says, "This is a guy who's not going to tip me." So, understandably, he provides bad service. On day three, the black customer says, "This is the guy who's going to provide bad service," and so he leaves no tip. Those of you who are interested in economic modeling and game theory will recognize this problem. The standard strategy for inducing cooperation is tit for tat. One cooperates until the other person defects, and then defects until the other person begins to cooperate. But the problem with the strategy is that if both sides are pursuing it, once the tit for tat equilibrium gets established, it's impossible to move away from it. We can think of racism as a giant game of tit for tat stuck in a dysfunctional equilibrium. Now, how does this play out with regard to criminal justice? Here, the problem is further complicated and aggravated by our commitment to two inconsistent ways of thinking about criminal punishment, which I will label the economic model and the moralist model. The economic model treats crime and efforts to control crime as the rational response to incentives. On this model, The government sets the price of crime at a level designed to produce the optimal amount, that is, the level of crime such that the social cost of preventing the last unit is just below the cost of the crime itself. Criminals and potential criminals, in turn, treat the risk of punishment as the cost of doing business. They, too, rationally calculate costs and benefits and commit crimes if, but only if, the benefit they receive is greater than the threatened punishment, discounted by the likelihood that it will be inflicted and appropriately adjusted according to the taste for risk. A deficiency of the economic model is that it seems descriptively inaccurate, or at least quite incomplete. Anyone who has studied the politics of crime, crime control, knows that it is driven at least as much by anger and fear as by careful cost-benefit analysis. Policymakers can talk openly about the cost and benefit of, say, decreasing the amount of benzene in the environment, but no one says publicly that there is an optimal level of rape and murder. It's not surprising, then, that our actual policies depart substantially from the results we would attain if we focused only on economic efficiency. On the other side of the ledger, it's extremely implausible that the threat of punishment alone motivates most people to obey the law. And it's obviously not true that most people need to be incapacitated in order to prevent crime. The vast majority of people would obey the law, or at least most laws, even if they were not worried about punishment. Put differently, we would live in a very different world if everyone committed every crime that they thought they could get away with. Now, standing in opposition to the economic model is the moralist model. On this model, punishment designed to achieve purely instrumental goals at the base of the economic model is impermissible. Instead, the government should punish crime on the basis of moral desert, and the extent of punishment should be calibrated to the extent of blame. The targets of potential sanctions, in turn, do not only calculate costs and benefits, rather most of them desist from crime because they have internalized the same standards of blameworthiness that motivate and justify the punishment. The moralist model may be more descriptively accurate, but it suffers from problems of its own. The central difficulty is that it rests on ideas about free will, blameworthiness, and desert that are disputed at best and totally incoherent at worst. True, there may be widely shared intuitions about polar cases and about the general structure of moral desert, although even that point is disputed. But even within this general agreement, if indeed such an agreement exists, there is no obvious and uncontroversial algorithm that converts these intuitions into an exact ranking of relative blameworthiness, or more importantly, into precise levels of punishment. The effort to define these gradations rests on extremely problematic assumptions about moral agency, assumptions that cannot be proved empirically and that may well make no sense philosophically. In the real world, of course, both the economic and the moralist model are at work on both law enforcement, on both the law enforcement and the criminal, potential criminal side of the ledger. The amount of crime and incarceration we end up with may be crucially influenced by the balance between the two models. For present purposes, though, the important point is not just that each model has problems of its own, but also that the interaction between the two models can produce pathological outcomes when combined with race and class dynamics that I've already described. To see the difficulty, first, we need to notice that the bright line I've so far drawn between the two models can be deeply misleading. Each model has a tendency to collapse into the other. So, even if we were fully committed to the economic model, it is still likely that the most economically efficient way to produce a low level of crime at low cost is to inculcate moral inhibitions against criminal activity. Norms of that sort will prevent people from committing crime even when doing so is personally advantageous. Society, therefore, need not bear the cost of making criminal activity personally advantageous to everybody who might otherwise commit a crime. In a world where people have not absorbed these norms, the probability of detection and severity of punishment needs to be extremely high in order to reduce crime to an acceptable level. Even from the economic point of view, then, it makes sense for criminal sanctions to be imposed, or at least to seem to be imposed, on a moralist basis. Just as the economic model tends to collapse into the moral model, so too the moral model tends toward collapse into the economic model. As I've just said, our standards of blameworthiness, I don't think, can withstand serious analysis. As many other people have shown, if one takes a broad enough view, all criminal conduct is in some sense caused by factors beyond the actor's control and for which the actor is not to blame. Conversely, if one takes a narrow enough view, all criminal conduct is caused by an act of will for which the subject is to blame. Sometimes we take a broad view, sometimes we take a narrow view, and despite heroic efforts by its many apologists, no one has adequately justified this shift of focus. In the face of this philosophical incoherence, it's easy for the culpability standard to turn into an economic efficiency standard. We end up blaming when it's useful for us to blame. Whether it is useful in turn depends on some sort of cost-benefit analysis. So, for example, sometimes we seem to determine blameworthiness by selfishly, if often unconsciously, calculating the costs of being victimized by crime as against the risk of being labeled a criminal. The intersection of the economic and moral models and the tendency of each to collapse into the other produces serious pathologies when combined with problems of race and class. Consider first the economic side of the ledger. Punishment as blame may indeed be economically efficient, but it achieves this efficiency only if its economic motivation is obscured. Blaming is instrumentally effective precisely because it's perceived as motivated by moralism. Problems therefore arise when those threatened by criminal sanctions begin to believe that the punishment is economically motivated. What about the moralist side? As I've already mentioned, in the absence of good non-instrumental standards for blaming, the practice tends to devolve into a kind of unconscious cost-benefit analysis. Given that fact, it's not surprising that mainstream groups and target groups develop different standards of culpability. The risk of criminal violence is against the risk of being labeled a criminal is different for the two groups, and so they will have different views of relative culpability for the same act done under the same circumstances. Now, to be clear, the two communities need not disagree on fundamental questions of right and wrong. It is enough that the target community perceives that the calibration of moral fault to the degree of punishment is out of kilter, or if it at least believes that the norms are being applied more harshly to them than to others. Under these circumstances, the target community will see itself as being unfairly singled out. It will see the dominant community is not really following norms, but instead acting in narrow self-interest. Moral incentives to obey will therefore erode and be replaced by mere economic incentives, because from a moral point of view, the threat of punishment is perceived to be unjust. Avoiding criminal sanctions turns into little more than a prudential concern, because the risk of punishment is just a cost of doing business, the level of crime rises. When the target group commits more crime, the mainstream community becomes more morally indignant, which in turn leads to still harsher sanctions. Targets of these sanctions feel even more unfairly treated, so they feel even less moral obligation to obey the law. Their still more outrageous conduct produces more moral anger, and so forth. The important point is that once this cycle begins, the perception of otherness becomes self-reinforcing. Because the targets perceive themselves as unfairly singled out, their conduct is less constrained by majority moral norms, and so they, in fact, become other. This dynamic explains how hyper-incarceration can coexist with the emergence of a black middle class, the election of a black president, and a perceived decline in racial tension. The successful emergence of some African Americans from a segregated world dominated by poverty and racial concentration serves only to further narrow and isolate the target, thereby increasing its disconnect from mainstream norms, which in turn reinforces mainstream perceptions of otherness. Negative stereotypes about the remaining target population come to seem normal and empirically justified, while nagging guilt about racism is quieted by the counterexamples of African Americans who've been assimilated. The fragile assimilated status of these African Americans, in turn, rests crucially on their ability to separate themselves from the despised underclass that is left behind, the racial solidarity that might otherwise ameliorate the isolation, therefore fails to take hold. As Michelle Alexander, among others, has demonstrated, hyper-incarceration itself further intensifies this isolation. Incarcerated individuals become non-persons. They are hidden from our view and have little contact with the outside world. They cannot vote or assert themselves politically in any meaningful way. Individuals returning to their communities after a period of imprisonment find their family lives shattered, their community ties disrupted, and paths to meaningful employment blocked. No wonder, then, that the recidivist rates are high and that the prospects of forming political and effective links with those in the mainstream community are so bleak. It's that dynamic, I think, played out on a very large scale and involving not just criminal justice but more general social breakdown that leaves us with millions of our citizens behind bars. Very recently, though, we've begun to see a stabilization and perhaps the beginning of a decline in incarceration rates. Some of the decline is probably attributable to delayed reaction to a reduction in crime rates. A good deal of it, though, comes from an unlikely source. Predictably, people on the left have complained for years about the social injustice of mass incarceration, but we're just beginning to see a conservative reaction to it as well. And in fact, there are aspects of conservative thought of varying degrees of respectability that support an attack on hyper-incarceration. At the base of all of them is a recognition of the fact that hyper-incarceration is a big, bloated government program with all the negative connotations that conservatives regularly attach to that label. Apart from the defense establishment, it's hard to think of another activity of government that involves so many people, such a large share of the public fisc, and so much waste. Moreover, hyper-incarceration is not just any big government program. It's a massive experiment in social engineering. Like, say, welfare or a cap-and-trade regime for carbon, it assumes that bureaucrats will be able to diagnose and solve very large social problems through government fiat. Conservatives have every reason to reject that assumption. For fiscal conservatives, worry about massive government spending, high taxes, and huge deficits also causes a concern about hyper-incarceration. Every prisoner costs the government an average of $23,867 per year to maintain, and the prison system averages about 7% of state general fund spending. In times of prosperity, perhaps we could indulge our taste for retribution. In these leaner times, long sentences become a luxury that we just can't afford. One has to ask as well, who exactly benefits from these expenditures? And that question, in turn, suggests the possibility that the racism historically supporting hyper-incarceration might actually be made to face in the opposite direction. Despite well-publicized cases of cross-racial violence, the fact is that the vast majority of victims of African-American crimes are themselves African-Americans. Most African-American drug dealers sell drugs to other African-Americans, and African-Americans are the victims of the overwhelming majority of murders committed by African-Americans. Years ago, when I worked for the District of Columbia Public Defender Service, One of the judges I regularly appeared before was a notorious and disgusting racist. Counterintuitively, at least in some kinds of cases, my colleagues and I would try to get our cases assigned to him. The reason was that in cases of black-on-black crime, he thought this was about all you could expect from black people, and that it wasn't worth the time or effort to give them long sentences. Similarly, from a certain angle, racism actually cuts against hyper-incarceration. Viewed from this angle, hyper-incarceration might be characterized as yet another effort to tax middle-class white people for the benefit of a black underclass. So for these reasons, I think there's ground for some hope that we've reached the crest in the huge hyper-incarceration phase. The important point I want to make, though, is that none of these reasons has anything to do with the underlying dynamic that produced the problem in the first place. The reductions are produced by economic concerns. They have nothing to do with the desire to achieve racial justice, and as I've suggested, may actually be the product of racism. The same downward and self-reinforcing spiral that creates its own reality, justifying subjugation, therefore still exists. It follows, I think, that the same dynamic that produces huge prison populations will now produce new means of social control and repression that will, to some degree, replace prisons. So what do these new means of social control look like? Here I want to focus on three replacements for hyper-incarceration: stop and frisk, non-custodial sanctions, and specialized courts. Let's start with stop and frisk. As everyone in this room knows, the stop and frisk doctrine, if not the practice itself, was born in 1968 in a Supreme Court, a famous Supreme Court decision called Terry versus Ohio. In that case, Officer McFadden, on duty in Cleveland, Ohio, saw three men acting suspiciously in the downtown area, and he thought they might be preparing to rob a store. He approached the men, and after a very brief exchange, frisked them and found a gun. The Supreme Court held that Officer McFadden had reasonable suspicion to believe that the suspects were armed and dangerous, and that was sufficient for him to frisk them in order to protect himself from the danger. Fair enough, but there is an enduring puzzle about the case. Officer McFadden was endangered only if he approached and questioned the men. So we have to ask, what was the legitimate interest served by approaching them in the first place? After all, he had just gone about minding his own business. They weren't about to just pick him out randomly and shoot him. So why did he have to approach them? At first, the answer seems obvious. He needed to do this to prevent a crime from being committed. But if you think about it for a moment, that doesn't work. As it happens, Officer McFadden was in plain clothes that fateful day, but he could have accomplished his crime prevention goal simply by wearing his uniform to work. Since he was in plain clothes, he could have simply yelled out, "Hey, I'm Officer McFadden, a police officer. Don't do it, Terry," right? Or put up a big sign saying, "I'm a police officer, you're being watched." And that, I think it's fair to say, would have stopped the armed robbery from occurring. Perhaps then, Officer McFadden needed to approach Terry to investigate. But what exactly would this investigation consist of? So let's imagine a truly unlikely but very best case scenario. McFadden, who are you and what are you doing? Terry, surely you've heard of me. I'm the famous Terry from the Terry versus Ohio. I'm thinking of robbing a store, okay? Now, turns out, even on those facts, it's not at all clear that Officer McFadden could have done anything at all. After all, it's not a crime to think about committing a crime. I suppose conceivably Terry was guilty of a conspiracy or an attempt, but of course this hypo is wildly unlikely. The most likely possibility is that Terry would not confess on the spot and that the investigation would come to nothing at all. Perhaps then, McFadden approached Terry so that he could conduct the frisk and find the gun. That seems much more likely, but now the tail is wagging the dog. The frisk, the Supreme Court tells us, is justified so that the officer can be safe while conducting the stop. But now it turns out the stop is justified so that the officer can conduct the frisk, and we're in a perfect circle. Here's the most likely possibility. McFadden, and by extension, the thousands of police officers who have conducted stops and frisks since 1968, have nothing nearly this specific in mind. What these officers are doing instead is simply controlling the situation, a situation that always threatens to spin out of control. They're getting guns and drugs off the street, but even if they find no drugs or guns, they are reminding people that police officers are around, that it's the police who are the boss, and that they had better watch their steps. Perhaps not coincidentally, at the very time that Terry was decided, the practice of Jim Crow was finally beginning to decline throughout the South. Jim Crow presents a very similar parallel puzzle. One could perhaps understand, even if one surely did not condone, the white racist desire to prevent black people from messing with their women or going to school with their kids. But racial apartheid was carried far beyond measures like that. It extended to bathrooms, water fountains, even which side of the street people were walking on. Why did Jim Crow have to include these daily humiliations as people went about their ordinary activities? Here's what Joel Williamson says about the practice in his great book, The Crucible of Race, and I'm quoting here. The motive of white Southerners was to depress the expectations of blacks, especially black men, to make them less secure and ultimately less aggressive. White Southerners readily recognized that blacks were already practically disfranchised and segregated, but to them, the laws were useful in showing explicitly and blatantly the power of whites. They were tokens of hard present truths and signs of things to come, of the surety of white supremacy and the futility of black resistance. Sound familiar? Is it completely coincidental that the rise of mass incarceration accompanied the decline of Jim Crow, and that the recent explosion of stop and frisk accompanies the decline of mass incarceration? Is it completely unfair to say that stops and frisks are performing some of the functions performed by Jim Crow in the late 19th and early 20th century, and that stop and frisk is now performing some of the functions performed by mass incarceration in the late 20th century? As reported by Paul Butler in a recent article, the number of stops and frisks in New York City nearly doubled from 2004 to 2010. In that year, the police stopped over 600,000 suspects. In a single 8-block area of Brooklyn, Brownsville, the police conducted nearly 52,000 stops in a period of 4 years, an average of one stop each year for every resident of the community. Men between the ages of 15 and 34 make up 70% of those stops, which means that a young male living in the area averaged about 5 stops per person per year. Citywide, 90% of the stops lead to absolutely nothing, and guns are found in only 0.15% of the cases. In Brownsville, 13,200 stops in 2010 led to a grand total of 109 arrests, and the hit rate for guns was 0.05%. Now, Professor Butler thinks that these statistics mean that stops and frisks are pointless. I have to say, I'm not so sure. If one thinks of stops and frisks as an alternative means of social control that substitutes for incarceration, then the fact that people aren't arrested turns out to be exactly the point. As, in fact, work done by Frank Zimmering at least suggests, increases in stop and frisk may have produced a reduction in crime because as an alternative means of social control. What happens, though, when suspects are arrested? Understandably, scholars and commentators have focused on our huge incarceration rates, but this has caused them to lose sight of what happens to the much larger number of criminal defendants who never go to prison. And that leads to the second substitute for mass incarceration, non-custodial sanctions. Here, I rely on a remarkable and groundbreaking study of a New York City misdemeanor court by a young scholar associated with this institution, Issa Kohler-Hausman. For those of you who don't know her, it's worth your while to get to know her. As she reports, while the crime rate and felony arrests have both sharply decreased in New York over the last two decades, misdemeanor arrests have sharply increased by 111% since 1990. In fact, there are now roughly twice as many misdemeanor as felony arrests in New York City. There are two remarkable facts about these misdemeanor cases. First, they almost never lead to incarceration. And indeed, a huge percentage of them result in ultimate dismissals. But second, they serve as an important instrument of social control. Kohler-Hausman characterizes the methods of social control by what she calls marking, procedural hassle, and performance. Marking is the official state declaration that a defendant has become enmeshed in the criminal justice system. Convicted defendants have a rap sheet. They frequently have their fingerprints, pictures, and increasingly their DNA on file. Even if their case is ultimately dismissed and their record sealed, they have an open case on file, readily available to anyone with a computer, during the pendency of the case, and these cases often drag on for a very long time. This has an obvious effect on the ability of these people to get a job, housing, or credit. Procedural hassle, to quote Kohler-Hausman, involves the degradation of arrest and police custody, the frequency of court appearances, the stress of having the case ongoing. It encompasses the opportunity costs of lost work, childcare, family or social responsibilities, and other obligations that have to be foregone to make the endless court appearances and comply with any court orders during the pendency of the case. For example, misdemeanor defendants in New York have to wait up to 12 hours, sometimes overnight, in holding pens. Here's how Kohler-Hausman describes the conditions. The pens measure no more than 25 by 25 feet, with perhaps 27 defendants and a single toilet in a corner open to public view. According to Kohler-Hausman, unsanitary is an understatement in describing these pens. Rats, mice, and roaches are common sighting, and smashed cheese sandwiches, the only food offered during the entire arrest to arraignment period, are all over the floor. Often, people have to stand up all night in these conditions. Finally, Kohler-Hausman defines performance as, quote, the requirement that the defendant discharge some duly assigned task, program activity, or therapeutic undertaking. The type of performance ranges from community service to various therapeutic interventions to educational activity. Some of this activity may actually be valuable and well-intentioned. There can be no doubt about this, though. All of it is and is often meant to be a way of exercising power over the defendants. As Kohler-Hausman puts it, this form of social power is unlike incarceration in that it does not involve constant surveillance or total control. Instead, it is imperfectly and haltingly sought and sometimes achieved through record keeping, rewarding successful action, and punishing unsuccessful compliance. Failure to comply has consequences, sometimes an arrest warrant or incarceration, but more often simply more marking and procedural hassle. The performance technique for controlling misdemeanor defendants is closely related to the third method of alternative social control I want to mention, and that is specialty courts. And here I rely on the work of another brilliant young scholar. Her name is Allegra McLeod. In an article soon to be published in the Georgetown Law Journal, McCloy demonstrates that in recent years, many, many jurisdictions have experimented with a bewildering array of alternative courts designed to reduce levels of incarceration. We now have drug courts, mental health courts, reentry courts, even veteran courts. Now, McCloy is skeptical about many, perhaps even most of these efforts, but she thinks that some of them, including some of them here in New York City, hold out considerable promise. And she may be right about this, but in keeping with my general orientation toward life, I wanted to emphasize the downside. First, alternative courts have the potential to legitimate the cruelty and brutality suffered by the people who don't qualify for the courts. If I'm not a veteran, I'm not a drug addict, I'm not mentally ill, I'm sorry, if I am a veteran, or I am a drug addict, or I am mentally ill, then I have some excuse for what I've done, and it mitigates the evilness of the act I've otherwise performed. But what if I don't fit into any of those categories? Then I must be the worst of the worst and deserving of whatever happens to me. Second, there can be no doubt that one effect of the specialized courts is to regulate many aspects of a defendant's life that could never be regulated under traditional criminal law. For example, participants in drug courts are typically required not just to abstain from illegal drugs, but also from perfectly legal products like alcohol. Some defendants are made to wear tracking devices that keep track of their every movement. They must report for frequent urine tests. They face legal discipline for things like being late for work, for not being sufficiently receptive to psychotherapy, or even for just not having a positive attitude. All of that is justified by a combination or an intersection of two ideological moves, both of which I think are quite destructive. We have the rhetoric of therapy and the rhetoric of consent. The rhetoric of therapy claims that criminals, or at least these criminals, are not evil, as the standard story claims. Instead, they are sick. As far back as the 1950s, Stephen Sondheim perfectly captured this rhetoric, and I can't resist the urge to quote, although you'll be relieved to hear I'm not going to sing. It goes like this. Officer Krupke, you're really a square. This boy doesn't need a judge. He needs an analyst's care. It's just his neurosis that ought to be curbed. He's psychologically disturbed. Officer Krupke, you're really a slob. This boy doesn't need a doctor, just a good, honest job. Society has played him a terrible trick, and sociologically, he's sick. On this view, then, criminal offenders need treatment rather than punishment. Superficially, this social hygiene model may be more humane, but it has a serious dark side. Because the defendant is not being blamed, she need not be blameworthy, and the invasion of freedom need not be proportional to guilt. Instead, we are justified doing anything necessary to cure the patient. So, for example, the United States Supreme Court has upheld civil commitment, supposedly designed to treat defendants for sex crimes, even though they have already completed their lawful sentence. The rhetoric of consent extends social control on a somewhat different theory. Here, the theory is that the defendant is legitimately subject to greater deprivations. A defendant legitimately subject to greater deprivations has the right to consent to lesser deprivations. So, to take a particularly notorious example, a Texas judge gave a convicted sex offense defendant the choice between imprisonment on the one hand and castration on the other. Now, to be sure, most defendants before specialized courts do not face choices as draconian as that, but the argument that the defendant could be subject to incarceration nonetheless justifies many forms of social control that would otherwise be illegitimate. To take but one example, again from the U.S. Supreme Court, the courts held that a state can condition a grant of probation on a defendant's willingness to give up her Fourth Amendment right not to be subject to searches without a warrant or probable cause. If that constitutional right collapses in the face of an argument from consent, one wonders what other rights are in jeopardy. Could a judge sentence a defendant to probation on the condition that he join the Catholic Church, that he wear a GPS system for the rest of his life, that she not get pregnant, that she refrain from associating with people who advocate the legalization of drugs? Now, let me hasten to add, I know of no specialized courts that have imposed any of those conditions. Still, one can't help worrying about slippery slope problems. Once sanctions become detached from blameworthiness and are viewed as substitutes for incarceration, we quickly lose our moorings. What precisely are the principled limits on what we can do to people accused of crimes when they consent to it because of the threat of incarceration? That brings us to the final question I want to raise tonight. What are we to think of substitutions like stop and frisk, non-custodial control, and specialized courts as a replacement for incarceration? On the one hand, it's certainly possible to view these substitutions as signs of progress. We should never minimize the sheer brutality of the American prison system. The hassle and degradation of misdemeanor courts and the infantilization and threat to civil liberties posed by treatment courts is, from one vantage point, surely preferable to long periods of incarceration in barbaric conditions. Even the humiliation of racially targeted and pervasive stops and frisks, in some sense, is better than prison, if that is indeed the choice that we face. On the other hand, though, one cannot escape the sense that we are slipping into a Foucauldian nightmare. Whatever else one wants to say about incarceration, and there is surely a lot to say about it, it at least provides a bright line between the world of freedom and the world of bondage. There are people on one side of the wall and people on the other side. And so long as one remains on the right side of the wall, one has rights that must be respected. The new forms of social control may put more people on the right side of the wall, but they do so at the expense of diluting the rights we usually associate with freedom. Once we get used to the idea of large numbers of supposedly free citizens subjected to this sort of invasion, the risks of slipping into a society that controls many aspects of our daily lives greatly increases. So the question is the trade worth it? And Rachel said I was going to end with some ringing marching orders to people, but sorry, Rachel, I'm not going to do that, because the honest answer is I'm just not sure. It's really a hard choice. I must say, though, and I will say this, the necessity of facing this trade fills me with anger and despair. Anger because a country that thinks of itself as free should not be put to this choice, and despair because until we find a way of breaking out of the vicious, self-reinforcing cycle of racism, hatred, fear, and social breakdown, the choice is unavoidable. And I think I'll stop there, and happy to take objections, questions, protests, whatever people want to do. How do you want to do this, Rachel? So they're not leaving in protest?
No.
Is that, all right.
Gingrich used that argument, divided Supreme Court.
Supreme Court. So what, if anything, do you make of the California experience as a model for the future?
So I think I should have emphasized this more than I did. I view it as still undecided whether, in fact, things are going to stabilize. And as you say, there are still many conservatives who think that, God help us, we're not locking enough people up. But having said that, I do think there are definite signs in the other direction in some very unlikely places. So, for example, in Mississippi, the level of incarceration has gone down quite substantially, and there are serious efforts to reduce the prison population. And I think even in California, maybe especially in California, there are economic necessities that push hard in the other direction. Now, California is complicated by the fact that, in addition to conservatives, you have the prison unions, which are tremendously powerful, not to mention the private prison system, which lobbies for more incarceration. So I'm not saying for sure the rate is going to decline. My point is more that to the extent it does decline, it's inevitable that it's going to be replaced by other mechanisms of social control.
Really enjoyed your talk.
Thank you, Debbie.
But at least for me, it comes across as though, you know, there are these four choices, and one is incarceration, and then the three substitutes for incarceration, and perhaps the three substitutes came about because we weren't quite prepared for, you know, what we were going to do with some other people. But what would you like to see? I mean,
I would like to see an end to racism, right? I think that is ultimately, and racism and classism, and so this, the kind of self-reinforcing social breakdown that I described. Now, if the question is, how does one bring that about, given our politics, if you have some ideas, I'd be glad to hear them. Oh, of course, but.
So what would you like to see have done? So the racial issue has been taken care of, what would you like
okay.
to see?
Okay. So I am a big fan of, where necessary, of short periods of imprisonment. One of the things that a number of people have shown, now there is the incapacitation argument, but in terms of the cost of imprisonment, it's really front-loaded. So when you go to prison, that really disrupts your life and makes a big difference. When you're talking about the marginal disruption caused by your 26th year as opposed to your 25th year, that's very small. There's also very good data demonstrating that the tendency of people to commit crimes drops radically sometime in people's mid-20s. So these gigantic prison terms that people are serving in the United States don't make a lot of sense. And indeed, the Republicans eviscerate Medicare, it may not be necessary because the prisons are going to, you know, the superannuated people are going to just get their free health care in prison from now on. I'm only joking, I think. So I think something like that in an ideal world would be much better. It is worth pointing out that just how unusual the United States is in this regard, and David, among other people, has really written very perceptively about this. Other countries quite like us, manage to function quite nicely without anything like the levels of social, of at least of obvious social control that the United States uses.
Okay, so I'm next.
if I understood your talk correctly, these are alternatives or substitutes to mass incarceration. So if you don't incarcerate, then you could have these alternative courts, or you could use stop and frisk. And I'm actually wondering if empirically it's right to think of them as substitutes, or in fact to think of them as being fostered by the exact same dynamics, so that it doesn't necessarily mean that if you just look at the timing of things like stop and frisk, or the timing of some of the, at least the early drug courts, I'm not sure if they correspond or correlate with a drop of incarceration. They may have just been coming along at the same time.
Right.
So I guess I'm just wondering how much you think these are, in fact, there's some kind of ratchet going on when you get more of one as incarceration goes down, or if in fact they're actually just all part of the same trend, and you don't reduce incarceration just because you have these things.
So we might end up with the worst of all worlds. And I'm certainly not going to deny that. Thank you for suggesting something that might be even more pessimistic than my own views. And there are distinguished and important social scientists in the room. So I'm not about to, having done no studies about this, I'm not about to make wild causal claims here. But I will just say this. You have two things that make me think that there's something to my story. One is, as you say, at the very moment that incarceration rates are going down, these other things are going up. So the number of misdemeanor prosecutions, stop and frisk, and alternative courts have all gone up while the incarceration rate is stabilized or is going down. And then the second point is, this is not something that I've made up. People have advocated these things as a way of reducing incarceration. So when these special courts have been sold, they've often been sold on economic grounds, that we can't afford any more to have this many people in prison. And so this is something we're going to do instead. And similarly, people have argued, important people with power have argued, that stop and frisk is a way of reducing crime without incarcerating people. Now, maybe those people are deluded. Maybe that's not the reason it's happening. But it seems to me that there's at least some evidence to support that there's a connection between the two. Oh, sure. And of course, the most obvious area where that is true involves drugs. So, we could just legalize drugs, and that would solve, I think, would solve a lot of our problems. Not all of them. I mean, even if every person convicted of a drug offense in the United States were released tomorrow, we'd still have a serious over-incarceration problem, but not nearly as serious. But I think that what you're saying stops one step too soon. The next question we then have to ask is, well, why is it that we have the enforcement strategies that we have? Why is it that police are arresting half a million, I forget what the number is, a very large number of people for misdemeanors in New York City every year? And I myself think the reason is that there is this perception that it's necessary to keep the lid on. And again, this is not this is not anything original. This is the broken windows theory. That, in other words, we have this this group of dangerous people who are other. They're not like you and me. We can't talk to them. We can't reason with them. They're alien, and we have to control them. And we can't, you know, as people wanted to do in 1850, we can't send them back to Africa. That's not acceptable. So we have to exercise the means of social control available. For a long time, we just threw them all in prison, but that turned out to be really expensive. So now we got to do it on the cheap. Now this is obviously a dramatically unfair characterization of exaggerated and unfair characterization of what goes on in the minds of whoever makes these policies. But I think it's not all that far from the truth. It is. The reason we have these enforcement strategies is because there's a perception in the dominant community that these are people who need to be under control, and this is a means of controlling them.
So I had another question, but I just wanted to react to that first, which is that one of the great beauties of your paper, I thought, was that you weren't taking that familiar route of attacking the substantive criminal law, for example, drug law, but instead focused on what I take it as the new literature on equality of deserve identifies not substantive law or punitive law and the sort of disenfranchisement, but rather differential patterns of contempt and enforcement, and particularly differential treatment under criminal procedure. So if you get racked up 3 times a week on an unfounded stopping risk, that tends to make you disenfranchised, much more disenfranchised than the issues of the objective of drug laws or objective of sentencing drug laws. So I thought that your focus on that sort of disenfranchisement was eliminating the pressure.
Well, thank you. You want to stop there? Before you go after me, let me just say a word about that, if you don't mind. So there is also a procedural aspect to the drug laws, and nobody has written more forcefully or movingly about this than my late friend Bill Stuntz. And the point he makes is that, you know, I mentioned it in my talk that African-American men commit a disproportionate number of street crimes, but they're not guilty of a disproportionate number of drug crimes. But they're caught and punished much, much more often. And there are a variety of reasons for that, but one of the reasons is that lower class drug markets are out of doors and upper class drug markets are indoors. And so perversely, the Fourth Amendment leads to racially disproportionate enforcement of the drug laws, because if you're going to go indoors, you need a warrant and probable cause and all that. For out of doors, you just need to stop and frisk the guy, or just it might just be in plain view. Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry. Right. Yes, and the exclusionary rule also doesn't apply in immigration proceedings.
And it also doesn't apply in grand jury.
Right.
So there
are these, by now I think, familiar critiques of the exclusionary rule, one of them being that there are lots of incentives for the police to do these things that the exclusionary rule doesn't deal with. So I think that's absolutely right.
I hope this doesn't sound too naive, but I'm wondering why there couldn't be a Sure.
Fit a racial profile. And I don't know whether you need to ascribe to whether it be the mayor, the police commissioner, or some higher authority the need to control and oppress.
So I don't think that's naive at all. On the contrary, I think it's absolutely right. And so I want to emphasize again the point I tried to make at the beginning, that it's wrong to think of racism as irrationality. The problem is these judgments are rational. So there is, in fact, more crime in African-American neighborhoods than there in some African-American neighborhoods than in some white neighborhoods. So this is a rational, in a sense, a rational police strategy. The problem is that it then produces this tit-for-tat equilibrium. So the people who live in those neighborhoods feel picked upon. Now they also, you know, what makes it all really complicated is they're also more often the victims. But they are certainly, they get the worst of both worlds. They're victimized by criminals, but they're also victimized by the police. And that in turn contributes one, I don't mean to say it's the only or even the main factor, but it's one of the things that produces the kind of social disconnect that gives them no stake in American society, which in turn leads to more crime, which leads to more crackdown, and so you have this tit-for-tat downward spiral that we need some way of breaking out of. I thought you were going to say, I'm scrambling for a way to say this nicely, right? All right, victory.
That, you know, we can think back on Andrew von Hirsch's reintroduction of Zurich theory to criminal law, thinking about punishment in America and elsewhere. That's kind of from a liberal perspective, what was co-opted by the right. It's kind of made this very simple, attributive argument. And I'm wondering whether you just packaged this kind of new platform for those on the right for a new
I think so, and one thing, as you were speaking, that occurred to me that I probably should have mentioned, but it just occurred to me. One of the things about these alternative mechanisms is precisely that people don't have to feel as guilty about using them, right? So by now, it's beginning to seep in that supermaxes are really terrible places, and even people, or especially maybe people on the evangelical right, are concerned about them. But if you dress this up in terms of therapy and making it better, and the person's agreed to it, then a lot of the inhibitions fall away. Now, it does have to be said also that some of them should fall away because it's not as bad. And that's what I think makes the trade-off hard.
Yeah, great talk. You talked about
thank you. Hi, John.
Public discourse, and you know, this cost-benefit argument going on, but obviously, like in the absence, let's say the economy turns around and we no longer are in, you know, the red ink. What about, you know, what would like a moral or a cultural kind of argument sound like? Given the difficulty of, like, I mean, obviously a moral argument against Jim Crow is a lot easier when you're dealing with middle-class blacks and poor blacks and people who aren't in prison. It affects everyone, right?
Right.
Scenario.
So I wish I had a good answer for you. There are people who are smarter than I am who are thinking hard about this, and I don't know whether what they've come up with makes a lot of sense or not. So here's one thing. My former colleague, James Foreman, who I think was here, what, last year? So he's proposed a program modeled on Teach for America, where idealistic young college graduates would go into prisons and provide education for prisoners. And his idea about this is not just that it would be good for the prisoners, but also that it would develop a cadre of people who, after this, for whom it would make a change in their lives, and that after they were through with this program, they would be committed to doing something about hyper-incarceration, going out and there are indeed there are some quite praiseworthy programs along these lines that bring college kids into prison. Some of them, the idea is to have a kind of mutual education where the prisoners are educating the students and the students are also educating the prisoners. It's really hard for me to be cynical about a program like that. I mean, it's just obviously so well-intentioned. And you know, maybe things like that will work, and you do have to start someplace. It's just that the problem is so big, and the roots, I think, the root causes of it are so deeply ingrained in American history that it is hard to see how we're going to break out of it. But the Washington Nationals have a great baseball team this year. So.
Well, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.